So Albert Einstein once said, the most beautiful thing we can experience is the mysterious. It is the source of all true art and all science. He to whom this emotion is a stranger, who can no longer pause and wonder and stand wrapped in awe, is as good as dead. His eyes are closed. Theosophy teaches us that mysticism is any doctrine involved in mystery and metaphysics, dealing more with the ideal worlds than with our matter-of-fact actual universe. The exact extent, depths, breadths, and lengths of the mysteries of nature are to be found only in Eastern esoteric sciences, says the secret doctrine. So vast, so profound are these that hardly a few, a very few of the highest initiates, those whose very existence is known but to a small number of adepts, are capable of assimilating the knowledge. Yet it is all there, and one by one, facts and processes in nature's workshops are permitted to find their way into exact sciences. While mysterious help is given to rare individuals to unravel the arcana. In his book, Spiritual Science, Why Science Needs Spirituality to Make Sense of the World, Dr. Steve Taylor, senior lecturer in psychology at Leeds Beckett University, wrote that the contemplative traditions like the writings of the Upanishads, Taoism, Neoplatonism, the Kabbalah, Christian mysticism and Sufism, for example, include the concepts of a fundamental spiritual force that pervades all things, as well as the space between, underlying the whole phenomenal world in which all things appear. There are variations among these concepts, but their similarities are striking. Why are scientists unable to detect this force? Because this is non-material. It would be the same as doing a brain scan and expecting to see consciousness. Every old religion is but a chapter or two of the entire volume of archaic primeval mysteries. Comparisons will be instituted and as much as possible be explained in the secret doctrine. The rest is left to the student's personal intuition. For in saying that Eastern occultism is a secret, is it not as if a complete or even approximate knowledge was claimed by the writer? Which would be absurd. What I know, I give out. That which I cannot explain, the student might find out for himself, said Madame Blavatsky. Anyone whose natural mysticism impels him to seek for sympathetic contact with other minds is astonished to find how large a number of persons are not only interested in mysticism generally, but are actually themselves Kabbalists. The river Dam during the Middle Ages has flowed since noiselessly underground and has now burst up as an irresistible torrent. Hundreds today study the Kabbalah, where scarcely one or two could have been found some 50 years ago, when fear of church was still a powerful factor in men's lives. But the long pent-up torrent has now diverged in two streams. Let me see. All true students of mysticism have good reason to believe that even when they do not absolutely know that the various schools of occultism considered from the highest, almost spiritual and abstract teaching lead to the same goal. They may be called by different names, and the methods in minor details may not be the same, but the wisdom of fond is identical. Moreover, esoteric philosophy reconciles all religions, strips every one of it outward human garments, and chose the root of each to be identical with that of every other great religion. It proves the necessity of an absolute divine principle in nature. It denies deity no more than it does a sun. Esoteric philosophy has never rejected God in nature, nor deity as the absolute ends. Ens is a unit of measurement used especially for estimating the total amount of space that will be required. Esoteric philosophy only refuses to accept any of the gods of the so-called monotheistic religions, gods created by man in his own image and likeness, a blasphemous and sorry caricature of the ever-unknowable. Furthermore, the records we mean to place before the reader embrace the esoteric tenets of the whole world since the beginning of our humanity, and Buddhistic occultism occupies therein only its legitimate place and no more. And to show you how exact a science is occultism, let me tell you that the means we avail ourselves of are all laid down for us in a code as old as humanity, to the minutest detail. We build our philosophy on experiment and deduction, says Mahatma Kutumi. Because all systems of religious mysticism are based on numerals. With Pythagoras, the monads of unity emanated the duad, and thus forming the trinity, and the quaternary, or arabil, the mystic four, composed the number seven. The sacredness of numbers begins with the first one, the one, and ends only with a naught or zero, symbol of the infinite and boundless circle which represents the universe. All the intervening figures, in whatever combination or however multiplied, represent philosophical ideas, from vague outlines down to a definitely established scientific axiom, relating either to a moral or a physical fact in nature. They are a key to the ancient views on cosmogony in its broad sense, including man and beings and the evolution of the human race spiritually, as well as physically. In the collected writings, it is confirmed again that God geometrizes, and number and numerals are the fundamental basis of all systems of mysticism, philosophy, and religion. The respective festivals of the year and their dates were all fixed according to the sun, the father of the calendars and of the zodiac, or the sun god and the 12 great but still minor gods. And they became subsequently sacred in the cycle of national and tribal religions. In the conclusion of the Key to Theosophy, Madame Blavatsky says, but I must tell you that during the last quarter of every 100 years, an attempt is made by those masters of whom I have spoken to help with the spiritual progress of humanity in a marked and definite way. Towards the close of each century, you will invariably find that an outpouring or upheaval of spirituality, or call it mysticism if you prefer, has taken place. Someone or more persons have appeared in the world as their agents, and a greater or lesser amount of occult knowledge and teaching has been given out. If you care to do so, you can trace these movements back century by century as far as our detailed historical records extend. When we hear the term secret doctrine, the first image that comes into our mind is probably Madame Blavatsky's book, which she wrote under the guidance of the two Tibetan adepts Kutumi and Moria. But it cannot be emphasized enough that this very book tells us the secret doctrine is the accumulated wisdom of the ages, and that the mysterious power of occult symbolism, which has actually occupied countless generations of initiated seers, are all recorded on a few pages of geometrical signs and glyphs. The system in question is no fancy of one or several isolated individuals. It is the uninterrupted record covering thousands of generations of seers whose respective experiences were made to test and to verify the traditions passed on orally by one early race to another, by men who have developed and perfected their physical, mental, psychic, and spiritual organizations to the utmost possible degree. No vision of an adept was accepted till it was checked and confirmed by the visions so obtained as to stand as independent evidence of other adepts and by centuries of experience. In a famous document from the early stages of the theosophical movement, known as the Letter of the Mahachohan, a Sanskrit term for the chief of a spiritual hierarchy, or the head of the Trans-Himalayan mystics or adepts to which the Mahatmas Kutumi and Moria belonged, who stood behind the modern theosophical movement, and which was passed on to some principal workers of that day, it is emphasized that the doctrine we promulgate must become ultimately triumphant, like every other truth, enforcing its theories with direct inference deduced from and corroborated by the evidence furnished by modern exact science. The advent of quantum physics at the beginning of the 20th century sent shockwaves through the scientific community when the perplexing and illusionary nature and behavior of matter and energy at the atomic and subatomic level started to emerge. The German physicist and Nobel Prize laureate Max Planck, originator of the quantum theory of energy, once said, "As a physicist, that is, a man who had devoted his whole life to a wholly prosaic science, the exploration of matter, no one would surely suspect me of being a fantast. And so, having studied the atom, I'm telling you that there is no matter as such. All matter arises and persists only due to a force that causes the atomic particles to vibrate, holding them together in the tiniest of solar systems, the atom. Yet in the whole of the universe, there is no force that is either intelligent or eternal. And we must therefore assume that behind this force, there is a conscious, intelligent mind or spirit. This is the very origin of all matter. This assumption is an important part of the timeless occult sciences, where it says, the one impersonal great architect of the universe is Mahat, the universal mind. Confirm the esoteric teaching, and Mahat is a symbol, an abstraction, an aspect which assumed a hazy entitative form in the all-materializing conceptions of man. The divine mind is and must be before differentiation takes place. It is called the divine ideation, which is eternal in its potentiality and periodical in its potency when it becomes Mahat, anima mundi, or universal soul. But remember that, however you name it, each of these conceptions has its most metaphysical, most material, and also intermediate aspects, says Madame Blavatsky. And that the universal mind is only another name for the absolute out of time and space. It is not an evolution, least of all a creation, but simply one of the aspects of the absolute which knows no change, which ever was, which is, and will be. Most probably derived from the term abso, a Chaldean expression of mystic space. The absolute is dormant, latent mind itself, and cannot be otherwise in true metaphysical perception. It is only its shadow which becomes differentiated in the collectivity of the Dhyanis, or the intelligent forces which are the vehicle for the manifestation of the divine or universal thought and will, and which give to and enact in nature her laws, They are not personifications of the powers of nature as erroneously thought, says HBB. With other words, behind the powers of nature, there is a transcendental intelligent force that guides them, just what Max Planck suspected. Niels Bohr, a Danish physicist and Nobel Prize laureate who made fundamental contributions to understanding the atomic structure and quantum theory, said that everything we call real is made of things that cannot be regarded as real. If quantum mechanics has not profoundly shocked you, you have not understood it yet. For a parallel to the lesson of atomic theory, we must turn to those kinds of epistemological problems with which already thinkers like Buddha and Lao Tse have been confronted, he says. Epistemology is a part of philosophy that deals with the study of how we know things. Challenged by the transcendental nature of the atomic and subatomic world, several other scientists became very aware of the connection with Eastern mysticism. Julius Robert Oppenheimer, an American theoretical physicist and professor of physics at the University of California, Berkeley, said already in the 1950s that the general notion about human understanding, which are illustrated by discoveries in atomic physics, are not in the nature of things wholly unfamiliar, wholly unheard of or new. Even in our own culture, they have a history, and in Buddhist and Hindu thought, a more considerable and central place. Dr. Victor Mansfield was professor of physics and astronomy at Colgate University in Madison County, New York. His research into quantum physics led him to a deep study of Eastern mysticism, especially the teachings of Buddhism, where the relation with modern quantum physics became more and more obvious to him. In his book, Tibetan Buddhism and Modern Physics, he wrote that although there is genuine divergence, which is the act of moving away in different direction from a common point, between science and Buddhism regarding the universality of objectification, which is expression of something abstract in a concrete form, both domains claim that anybody with sufficient talent and motivation could undergo the requisite training and have confirming experience with understanding mathematical theory and its connection to laboratory experiment, or the attainment of non-conceptual awareness of ultimate truths. The difference, however, is that in Buddhism, this attainment requires a transformation of the personality at the most profound level. In science, no such transformation of the individual is required. Following the usual route in science through a PhD and into contemporary research does require some native talent and much hard work. It does not require moral and spiritual transformation. He who would lift up high the banner of mysticism and proclaim its reign near at hand must give the example to others, says the Mahatma Kutumi. He must be the first to change his mode of life and, regarding the study of the occult mysteries at the upper step on in the ladder of knowledge, must loudly proclaim it such despite exact science and the opposition of society. The kingdom of heaven is obtained by force, say the Christian mystics. It is but with armed hand and ready to either conquer or perish that the modern mystic can hope to achieve his subject. And even stronger words are used in a letter to all theosophies. Observe, confirms the Mahatma Maurya, that the first step of gold which mount towards the temple of truth is a clean life. This means a purity of body and a still greater purity of mind, heart and spirit. How many of them, us, of course, violate one or more of these conditions of the right path and yet expect to be freely taught the highest wisdom and sciences, the wisdom of the gods. As pure water poured into the scavenger's bucket is befouled and unfit for use, so is divine truth and poured into the consciousness of a sensualist, pointed out especially as gluttony, eating and drinking for the sensual pleasures they give. There is a very, very ancient maxim, far older than the time of the Romans or the Greeks, more ancient than the Egyptians and Chaldeans. It is a maxim all of them, theosophists, ought to remember and live accordingly. And it is that a sound and pure mind requires a sound and pure body. Bodily purity every adept takes precaution to keep. Though such a person with any of the faults as above declared should fill the world with his charities and make his name known throughout every nation, he would make no advancement in the practical occult sciences, but will continually be slipping backwards. The 6 and 10 transcendental virtues, the paramitas, are not for full-grown yogis and priests alone, but for all those who would enter the path to enlightenment. And the 10 paramitas are generosity, giving help and benefit to other living beings, morality, live an ethical life, renunciation, renounce worldly pleasures, wisdom, achieve a right understanding of life and the world, energy, persistent effort, and not being discouraged by failures, patience, patiently accept life's up and downs, truthfulness, honesty, and truthful in all things, determination, unwavering determination to process on the path, loving kindness, show benevolence and compassion to all things, and equanimity, develop a perfect mental equilibrium. Dr. Fridtjof Capra, an Austrian-born American theoretical physicist, is probably one of the best-known scientists writing about the parallels between Eastern mysticism and modern physics. He is the founding director of the Center of Ecoliteracy at Berkeley University in California. Ecoliteracy is the ability to understand the natural systems that make life on Earth possible. In his book, Uncommon Wisdom, Dr. Capra writes that Eastern thought has begun to interest a significant number of people, and that meditation is no longer viewed as ridicule or superstition, that mysticism is being taken seriously, even within the scientific community, and that an increasing number of scientists are aware that mystical thought provides a consistent and relevant philosophical background to the theories of contemporary scientists. The first book he wrote about the parallels of Eastern mysticism with modern physics is called The Tao of Physics, which many of you might know. At first, it was very hard for him to find a publisher. When it actually happened in 1975, this book was an immediate bestseller in the United States and has since been published in 43 editions and 23 languages and is still in print. In this book, he points out that the parallels to modern physics with mysticism appear not only in the Vedas of Hinduism, in the I Ching, or in the Buddhist sutras, but also in the fragments of Heraclitus and in Sufism, which are the mystical teachings of Islam. He also emphasizes that a page from a journal of modern experimental physics, for example, will be as mysterious to the uninitiated person as a Tibetan mandala. Both are records of inquiry in the nature of the universe. The mystic and the physicist arrive at the same conclusion, one starting from the inner realm, the other from the outer world. The harmony between their views confirmed the ancient Indian wisdom that Brahman, the ultimate reality without, is identical to Atman, the reality within. Their observations take place in realms that are inaccessible to ordinary senses. In modern physics, these are the realms of the atomic and subatomic world. In mysticism, they are non-ordinary states of consciousness in which the everyday sensory world is transcended. In both cases, access to these non-ordinary levels of experience is possible only after long years of training within a rigorous discipline. And in both fields, the experts assert that the observation often defies expression in ordinary language. 20th century physics was the first discipline in which scientists experienced dramatic changes of their basic concepts and ideas. A paradigm shift from the mechanistic worldview of Descartes and Newton to a holistic and systemic conception of reality. Subsequently, the same change of paradigm occurred in the life sciences with the gradual emergence of the systems view of life. It should therefore not come as a surprise that the similarities between the worldviews of physicists and Eastern mystics are relevant not only to physics, but to science as a whole. If physics leads us today to a worldview with essentially mystical, says Dr. Capra, it returns in a way to the beginning. But this time, however, it is not only based on intuition, but also on experiment and great precision and sophistication, and on a rigorous and consistent mathematical formalism. But still, he says that while the new physics was developed in the 20th century, the mechanistic Cartesian worldview and the principles of Newtonian physics maintains a strong influence on Western scientific thinking, and that even today many scientists still hold to the mechanistic paradigm, although physicists themselves have gone beyond it. A paradigm means the totality of thoughts, perceptions, and values that form a particular vision of reality by which a society organizes itself. All scientific theories are approximations to the true nature of reality, and that each theory is valid for a certain range of phenomena. Quantum theory thus reveals the basic oneness of the universe. It shows that we cannot decompose the world into independently existing smallest units. As we penetrate into matter, nature does not show us any isolated building blocks, but rather appears as a complicated web of relations between the various parts of the whole. These relations always include the observer, he says, in an essential way. The human observer constitutes a final link in the chain of observational processes, and the properties of any atomic object can be understood only in terms of the object's interaction with the observer. When we look at the world around us, says Dr. Capra, we find that we are not thrown into chaos and randomness, but are part of a great order, a grand symphony of life. Every molecule in our body was once part of previous bodies, living or non-living, and will be a part of future bodies. In this sense, our body will not die, but will live on again and again because life lives on. Moreover, we share not only life's molecules, but also its basic principles of organization with the rest of the living world. And since our mind too is embodied, our concepts and metaphors are embedded in the web of life together with our bodies and brains. Indeed, we belong to the universe, and this experience of belonging can make our lives profoundly meaningful. One of the key insights of the systems approach has been the realization that the network is a pattern that is common to all life. Whenever we see life, we see networks. In the Mandukya Upanishad, one of a series of Hindu sacred treatises in Sanskrit, it is written, as a spider throws out and retracts its web, as herbs spring up in the ground, so is the universe derived from the undecaying one. Brahma is a germ of unknown darkness, is a material from which all evolves and develops as the web from the spider. This is only graphic and true. Brahma is, as a term derived from the root Bri, to increase, to expand. Brahma expands and becomes a universe woven out of its own substance. The expanding and contracting of the web, that is the world stuff or atoms, express here the pulsatory movement. For it is a regular contraction and expansion of the infinite and shoreless ocean of that which we may call the noumenon of matter, emanated by Svabhavat, a Buddhist term for the matrix of the universe, which causes the universal vibration of atoms. But it is also suggestive of something else. It shows that the ancients were acquainted with the cause of the first ignition of matter, or the world stuff, says HBD. Dr. Capra also mentions a discussion he had with Rainer Heisenberg, another famous quantum physicist and a Nobel Prize laureate, who worked closely with Niels Bohr, the Danish physicist whom we have mentioned before. In 1929, Heisenberg spent some time in India as a guest of the celebrated Indian poet Rabindranath Tagore, with whom he had long conversations about science and Indian philosophy. This introduction to Indian thought brought Heisenberg great comfort. He began to see that the recognition of relativity, interconnectedness, and impermanence as fundamental aspects of physical reality, which had been so difficult for himself and his fellow physicists, was the very basis of the Indian spiritual tradition. After these conversations with Tagore, Heisenberg said, some of the ideas that seemed so crazy suddenly made much more sense. It was a great help for me. Like in science and mathematics, a code or a formula is a system of letters, figures, or symbols used to represent a concise way of expressing information symbolically, especially for the purpose of transferring or sharing a secrecy with others. It seemed like a foreign language to somebody who is not initiated into the meaning of these symbols. Dr. Capra confirms, as we have heard before, that the important similarity between the ways of the physicist and the mystic is the fact that the observations take place in realms that are inaccessible to ordinary senses. In modern physics, these are the realms of the atomic and subatomic world. In mysticism, there are non-ordinary states of consciousness in which the everyday sensory world is transcended. Nikola Tesla, the famous Serbian-American inventor, electrical engineer and futurist, once said, the day science begins to study non-physical phenomena, it will make more progress in one decade than in all the previous centuries of its existence. And Frank Wilczek, professor of physics and Nobel Prize laureate, wrote in his latest book, Fundamentals, 10 Keys to Reality, a special quality of humans not shared by evolution or as yet by machines is our ability to recognize gaps in our understanding and to take joy in the process of filling them in. It is a beautiful thing to experience the mysterious and powerful too. And that dark energy presently accounts for about 70% of the universe mass. Nobody knows why several different, much larger contributions from various sources, some positive, some negative, conspire to give that particular final result. It is a big mystery. Dark energy could be a universal density of space itself. I think that the mystery of dark energy is what the Mahatma Kutumi describes in one of his letters, where he says, there is a force as limited, limitless as thought, as potent as boundless will, as subtle as the essence of life, so inconceivably awful in its rendering force as to convulse the universe to its center. Would it but be used as a lever? But this force is not God, since there are men who have learned to the secret of subjecting it to their will when necessary, says Mahatma Kutumi. The world of force is the world of occultism. And the only one whether the highest initiate goes to probe the secret of being. Hence, nobody but such an initiate can know anything of these secrets. Guided by his guru, or master of wisdom, the chela, or student, first discovers this world, then its laws, then the centrifugal evolution into the world of matter. To become a perfect adept takes him long years, but at last he becomes the master. The hidden things have become patent, and mystery and miracle have fled from his sight forever. He sees how to guide forth in this direction or that to produce desirable effects. The secret chemical, electrical, audio properties of plants, herbs, roots, minerals, animals, tissues, are as familiar to him as the feathers of your birds are to you. No change of the etheric vibration can escape him. He applies his knowledge, and behold, a miracle. To show you how exact a science occultism is, let me tell you that the means we avail ourselves of are all laid down for us in a code as old as humanity to its minutest detail. We build our philosophy upon experiment and deduction, says the Master Kutumi. And that modern science is our best ally. A good example is CERN, the European Organization for Nuclear Research, with a large Hadron Collider near Geneva in Switzerland, which is the world's largest and most powerful particle accelerator. The physicists and engineers are probing the fundamental structure of the universe. They use the world's largest and most complex scientific instrument to study the basic constituents of matter, the fundamental particles. Inside the accelerator, two high-energy particle beams travel close to the speed of light in opposite direction at a temperature of minus 271.3 degrees Celsius, colder than outer space, before they are made to collide. In the courtyard of the institution is a statue of the Hindu god Shiva. Why does one of the world's premier research institutes have a statue of the Hindu god Shiva in its premises? Unveiled on 18th of June 2004, the 2 meter tall statue was a gift from the government of India. A plaque next to the statue is a quote by Dr. Fridtjof Capra, explains its significance, where it says, hundreds of years ago, Indian artists created visual images of dancing Shivas in a beautiful series of bronzes. In our time, physicists have used the most advanced technology to portray the patterns of the cosmic dance. The metaphor of the cosmic dancers unifies ancient mythology, religious art, and modern physics. Dr. Capra further explained in his book, The Tao of Physics, that the dance of Shiva symbolizes the basis of all existence. At the same time, Shiva reminds us that the manifold forms in the world are not fundamental, but illusory and ever-changing. Modern physics has shown that the rhythm of creation and destruction is not only manifest in the turn of the seasons and the birth and death of all living creatures, but it is also the very essence of inorganic matter. According to quantum field theory, the dance of creation and destruction is the basis of the very existence of matter. Modern physics has thus revealed that every subatomic particle not only performs an energy dance, but is an energy dance, a pulsating process of creation and destruction. For the modern physicist, Shiva dance is a dance of subatomic matter, the basis of all existence and of all natural phenomena, says Dr. Kaplan. In an article called Modern Physics and Eastern Mysticism, Dr. Kapra writes that science and mysticism are two contemporary manifestations of the human mind, of its rational and intuitive faculty. The modern physicist experiences the world through an extreme specialization of the rational mind, the mystic through an extreme specialization of the intuitive mind. The two approaches are entirely different and involve more than a certain view of the physical world. However, they are complementary, as we have learned to say in physics. Neither is comprehended in the other, nor can either of them be reduced to the other, but both of them are necessary, supplementing one another for a fuller understanding of the world. Science does not need mysticism, and mysticism does not need science, he says, but man needs both. Mystical experience is necessary to understand the deepest nature of things. Science is essential for modern life. What we need is not a synthesis, but a dynamic interplay between mystical intuition and scientific analysis. Oriental traditions are full of allegories about the downfall of Pleroma, says the secret doctrine, of the gods and devas. One and all, they allegorized and explained the fall as a desire to learn and acquire knowledge, to know. This is a natural sequence of mental evolution, the spiritual becoming transmuted into the material or physical, the law of descent into materiality and descent into spirituality. The book of the Vedanta, derived from two words, Veda, knowledge, and Anta. Vedanta means the culmination of knowledge. It is the ancient Indian philosophy which answers the fundamental questions of life. And they give out but the metaphysical aspect of this world cosmogony, and their priceless thesaurus, the Upanishads, require now the additional possession of a master key to enable the student to get at their full meaning. Upanishad means, according to Brahmanical authority, to conquer ignorance by revealing the secret spiritual knowledge. And according to Sir Munya Williams, who was professor of Sanskrit at Oxford University and from whose writings HBB quotes, the title is derived from the root sat, with the prepositions upa and ni, and implies something mystical that underlies or is beneath the surface. And to close with a quote from the Collected Writings, the esoteric teachings remind us that the first necessity for obtaining self-knowledge is to become profoundly conscious of ignorance, to feel with every fiber of the heart that one is ceaselessly self-deceived. The second requisite is a still deeper conviction that such knowledge, such intuitive and certain knowledge, can be obtained by effort. The third and most important is an indomitable determination to obtain and face that knowledge. Self-knowledge of this kind is unattainable, but one man usually calls self-analysis. It is not reached by reasoning or any brain process, for it is the awakening to consciousness of the divine nature of man. To obtain this knowledge is a greater achievement than to command these elements and to know the future. Heed these words, you who wish to probe the depths of nature. If you do not find within yourself that which you seek, neither will you find it outside. If you ignore the wonders of your own house, how do you expect to find other wonders? In you is hidden the treasure of treasures. Know thyself, and you will know the universe and the gods, is an inscription attributed to the Oracle of Delphi. And a Buddhist axiom says, never give up. Great things take time. So, peace to all beings. Thank you.